does your heart good, doesn't it? A flashback to some of the great moments of football history here in the West Country. Now, in this program, we look at a young man who was groomed for soccer stardom from the moment he was born. Recognize him? Once called the golden boy of Bristol soccer, as a teenager hailed as the most exciting young player the West Country had ever produced.
Royal flicking on nicely. The chance here for young Mabbutt. And it's there! Oh, what a very good goal indeed!
Kevin Mabbutt, who turned down the glamour clubs to join Bristol City. A lad who made his start for them in the First Division exactly 10 years ago. And in four whirlwind years did more than his fair share for the club against some of the best sides in the land.
Bristol trying to be patient, looking for the opening. Man, Mabbutt, nice turn. Well, a nice effort by young Mabbutt. Tainter. Royal. Oh, a good turn. And a super shot from Mabbutt. But that was an excellent shot. Tainter. That's a good one. And Mabbutt's got it just wide. Well, young Mabbutt really climbed that beautifully. He could see the keeper was in trouble, but he couldn't quite keep it on the target. This is a chance for Mabbutt. Now can he make it 3-2? Oh, well, he did well, didn't he? Mabbutt. My goodness me, that boy Mabbutt, what he's done to this game since he came into it. Royal flicking on nicely. The chance here for young Mabbutt. And it's there! Oh, what a very good goal indeed!
And 10 years on, here he is, Kevin Mabbutt. Welcome.
Thank you.
Does it seem that long ago?
No, not at all. Seems like yesterday, really. I wish it happened yesterday. I mean, it would be closer for me to remember, but... They were good days, Roger.
Did I detect a perm then?
I think you detected about 10 different hairstyles in 10 different games, I'm sure of it.
Of course, we saw a left foot shot there against the crossbar, and the old left knee's gone now. The career's crumbled. 10 years, good years then?
Great years. I think I had 10 years, especially here at Bristol City. I mean, we had some great years here, and the players and the staff and everybody. We were one big family, really, Roger. As you know from yourself, I mean, you were closely... involved with the club, and there were great years. I mean, there's something to look back for and always remember, really.
But in your early days, it all seemed so perfect, didn't it, Kevin? England's schoolboy international, the top First Division clubs queuing up for your signature. Here's something for the family album. Young Kevin Mabbutt, 14 years old, taking part in a schoolboy kickabout on the park out Mangotsfield Way, about as far as you can get from the First Division. On the touchline is father Ray Mabbutt and a little boy, brother Gary, now the England defender. So many clubs were after young Kevin, it seemed that the boy could take his pick. His father, a former Rovers player, had groomed him from the moment he was born. Everything had been geared to soccer stardom. At this time, though, Kevin didn't fancy Bristol City.
Now, tell me why, then, the Arsenal, out of all this, what, dozen top clubs and the two Bristol ones, why are the Arsenal going to win your affection?
Well, they've got everything they've got. Past history, the last 50 years they've been in the First Division. They've got the players, they've got youngsters coming through, they've got the facilities, the most important to bring their young players through.
Of course, a lot of people would hope that you would join one of the Bristol clubs and then, if necessary, go on and be transferred for a big fee, and then everyone would be happy.
Yes, well, I think that's in everybody's mind in Bristol. But really, it should go straight to the top. You know, anybody's got to go somewhere in life has got to go to the top and not work their way up.
All those years ago, the attention was focusing on Kevin. No one thought then that Gary, in fact, would become the England star. They were moments for Father Ray, certainly, to savour.
Certainly, right from when we knew we were having a child, and when it was a son, obviously we wanted him to be a footballer. So the stage was set for him. He's been given every encouragement. And therefore I'm very satisfied that he's got as far as he has. We just hope he goes the rest of the way.
But after all that, Kevin did sign for Bristol City. A signature to be worth countless thousands to that club.
Didn't the glamour of the big clubs attract you at all?
Tremendously at first, and I used to say, I want to sign for this club and I want to sign for that club because there's so many good players there and I like being with so-and-so. But if you go to a top club, you're more likely to be led astray in life and your head could swell. But now I'm at home, then everybody can keep an eye on me.
Despite his age, City thought Kevin would be in their first team within a year. They were convinced they had a star. The stage was set.
You've turned down the big clubs. What's your big ambition?
My real ambition is to play for England in the World Cup and to be the captain and to win the World Cup.
Ambitious lad, weren't you?
I think he was too ambitious, even then.
Why not? The outrageous ambition of eternal youth, Kevin.
Sure.
Those were the days when Bristol City was on the road to promotion. You were only an apprentice, but a schoolboy international. How did those senior players react to you in those days, Kevin, when you first came into the camp as the Golden Boy?
Mm. They were very friendly. All the staff were very friendly. They always have been there and always were. But they had nothing to fear. They were established professionals. Other than some others might say something else about it, but I mean, that was my opinion at the time. I was a young guy coming into the game, very enthusiastic. I wanted to do well, but I had established players around me. So I think everyone got on very well, really.
None of them tried to teach you a lesson or two?
One or two of them, but I think we'll keep that quiet. And
the spring of 1976 and those magic weeks then leading up to promotion. Then the promised land with that Clive Whitehead goal and promotion itself. The supporters went wild, didn't they? And of course, the whole city of Bristol joined in those celebrations. The senior players, the Merricks, Riches, Whiteheads, Taintons, Sweeneys, Gillies, all the rest, they were in the spotlight, Kevin. What was it like for a young apprentice for you at that time? Did you feel slightly out of it, not being in the team?
No, not really. I mean, I remember this game very well. I mean, we were sat in the Dolman stand watching the game with a few of my friends, and this game I became a football supporter. I was there chanting with the supporters. At the end of the game we were singing, celebrating. That was a nice thing about it. I mean, I don't think anybody at the stadium felt out of it. I think everybody shared the success that night.
And of course that side had built a platform for you, got the club into the first division for you to later take part and become a star.
Right, it was a great feeling knowing that we got into the first division. We had a huge following, as you can see here, and the team was ready, and it was just a matter of time really before I got into the team and things went well.
Yes, and as we know, City were to survive that first season by the skin of their teeth up in Div 1. More of that later in the series. And then at the start of their second season, in September 1977, Kevin, you were thrown in at the deep end, your first division debut. You were 18 years of age, a crowd of 22,000 on a lovely day at Ashton Gate.
That's the new boy, Kevin Mabbutt, full of promise, 18 years of age, an England schoolboy international. This is his first game at home in the First Division. Good positional play by Mabbutt. Gow. Cormack. Hunter. Nice ball. Well laid off by Mabbutt. Cormack. Good Bristol move. Sweeney. Whitehead. Sweeney. Played in for Mabbutt, but it's not right, but not there, but he's made a mistake. Mabbutt has it. Ritchie. Taynton. Well, that was a costly mistake there by Ken McNaught. Not the sort of mistake one expects from a £200,000 man, and Trevor Taynton couldn't keep his shot on target. Getting past the fullback beautifully. It's a good cross. Mabbutt's up, and it's just good effort by Kevin Mabbutt there. He applauds the cross. Well, that's the nearest Bristol have looked for a goal for a long time. Now, can they make more of this corner kick? Well, they're trying to vary their approach. Hunter knocking it in. In goes Mabbutt. Oh, a brilliant effort there by young Mabbutt. Rimmer wants his defence to calm down. Hunter's lovely ball found Mabbutt getting in there, and Rimmer had to move smart to keep that one out. Jimmy Mann waiting for Gow's ball, but he plays it through for Whitehead. Phillips shadowing him. Whitehead into the box. A good little centre, and that's a goal! Bristol superbly. For once, Mabbutt was tall enough, and doesn't he know where the corner of the net lies? Well, a storybook home debut in the first division for Kevin Mabbutt. His first home game in the League Cup in midweek, and he gets the winner against Stoke. And today he gets the goal that puts Bristol back in the game against Aston Villa.
Looked quite pleased, didn't you?
Yeah, what did you mean by this time was tall enough?
Well, now you wait 10 years to tell me?
I remember it. Well, Roger.
How did you react to criticism at that age, incidentally?
Well, because of the family. I mean, my father brought us up the right way in football, so we accept criticism, as long as it's constructive, not destructive. We used to accept it.
Great start you made there, didn't you?
Yeah, I mean, I couldn't miss with Clive's cross. I mean, Clive had to be one of the best crossers in the game. I mean, still is, but I mean, he had to be one of the best crosses in the game. I mean, with Clive there on the wing, I knew you never had two or three chances a game where he could put it on your head as long as you put them away.
It was a one-all draw, I remember, wasn't it? You saved the game with that goal.
Yeah.
What do players like Hunter, you know, seen it all, how do they react to your start in the first division? Well played, lad, or nothing, or what?
No, sure. I mean, they were all excellent. They were all excellent towards me because I was young, I was enthusiastic. They'd seen it all. They'd been at the top of the tree for a long time. And my enthusiasm sometimes got the better of me. And the players were there to calm me down, which was great. And I mean, Norman, especially Peter, all the way through, the whole team, Terry. And then the players have been there a long time.
And the manager, of course, Alan Dix.
And the manager, of course, I mean, the manager, Ken Wimshurst. Everybody, it was such a nice atmosphere there. And if anybody got too big for their boots, I mean, which some of us did at times, they pulled us down, and in a nice way, not a very critical way.
Well, of course, you were in fact playing against the teams which were the mighty names of football at that time, weren't you? I suppose, Kevin, they were the golden days of Bristol City football.
Whitehead taking them on, the cross in, good luck, Mabbutt! Made the space for the goal! Yes! And didn't he take that well?
Then the red, red robin comes bobbing along, along. There'll be no more sobbing when he starts throbbing his old sweet song. Ah, wake up, you sleepyhead. Get up, get out of bed. Cheer up, the sun is red. Live, love, laugh and be happy. What if I've been blue? Now I'm walking through fields of flowers. Rain may glisten, but still I listen for hours and hours. I'm just a kid again, doing what I did again, singing a song. When the red, red robin starts bobbing along.
Hey, you got some good goals.
Fantastic. Some of these I haven't even seen myself. I can't remember them that well. It's nice to see them again.
You don't remember them?
Not that well, I don't know. I mean, a few of them I remember.
The business of goal scoring, a gift, or you got to work at it? You took some good ones there.
Yeah, it's a combination of things, really. But then the team we had at the time, I mean, we played some great football, as you've seen. I mean, we played some excellent football. And really, you're the bullet in the gun, really. And that's what happened. It's being in the right place at the right time, of course.
Now you've run out of bullets.
Now I've run out of bullets. But, I mean, that's life, isn't it? I can't complain. I've had a great career. I had a great career. Could have done better. But I enjoyed it very much.
Especially hitting the back of the net.
Especially hitting the back of the net. This used to be a great feeling.
And your goals brought great fame, and you certainly adopted the image of the soccer hero, didn't you? Remember Kevin Mabbutt, superstar? There was the sports car, the adoration of the fans, particularly the young and female variety, and the snazzy flat. What more could an 18-year-old want out of life? For a teenager, it was an absolute dream coming true, and later on there was even a big fan club, an Aston Martin, and some dangers. As you were saying, the pop world has its young stars, but of course it's a different life for an athlete. The temptations that a pop star perhaps has got time for, do you feel you have time for?
No. You either go one way or go the other. I've seen enough players in my career, and I've only been in the game 3 years, and I've seen enough players go out of the game because they've gone the other way. And I've been lucky to have a stable family behind me. And they've helped me in everything that I've done. And I seem to have gone for the game
and not against the game.
There was even the Kevin Mabbutt Roadshow. His advisers were determined to cash in on his popularity, but it was something that didn't always endear him to the fans.
Whenever a professional footballer goes out onto the pitch, nothing at all worries him. He just concentrates on scoring goals. If he doesn't score a goal, it doesn't mean he's thinking because, oh, I've got to do this and I've got to do that. It's nothing to do with that. What it is that when you get out on a pitch, you play soccer and you've got to score goals.
Well, this is the Kevin Mabbutt Magic Van, and it's going to be touring between 400 and 500 schools in the West over the next few months. And young fans will be able to buy their very own Kevin Mabbutt kit. It contains a fan club number, a Kevin Mabbutt picture, autographed of course, and even a Kevin Mabbutt magic pen.
Is that ecstasy or agony on your face, young man?
Agony, I'm sure. I'm not too happy with a few of those things there. Won the gold chains, I think my brother could give me a hard time for that.
Yeah. Was that your idea to have this fan club and that? Or even if it wasn't, I mean, right. You approved of it.
Sure, I mean, what we originally wanted to do turned out, in the end, it turned out nothing like what we wanted to do originally. We just caught called up in it, really.
What did you want to do?
Well, we just wanted to attract the children and the kids to soccer. That's all we did. I mean, that's why we did it. And it worked. But then after a short while, people started picking up on it, and of course, the media started changing a lot of things. We all got caught up in it.
Yeah, I thought it was a little too much, a little too early.
Oh, for sure. Yeah. Much too early. Much. I'd been in the game a very short time. And like I said, I got carried away.
You had your good times and you had your bad patches like everyone else, Kevin.
Right.
But for the most part, Bristol City certainly had their money's worth, I thought, out of you and out of that team.
Mabbutt robbing him. Mabbutt using his weight this afternoon. He's only a little lad, but he's learning how to use it all. Lovely ball. And Richie in. Richie. Cormack, and that one's in! It's for Hunter, and it's a lovely goal, extremely well taken by Norman Hunter.
Good positioning by Mabbutt again, and a lovely return ball to Merrick.
Richie and Mabbutt again. It's a lovely cross. Royal, Gow. Well, it just didn't bounce right for Gow. Garland up well. That's the goal for Peter Cormack.
Mabbutt, good cross. Royal's got Richie behind him. The chance for Gow.
Lovely ball to Royal. And it's Gow's shot that comes in.
Feeding Merrick. The ball is good. Cormack header. What a lovely header and a superb save from Jimmy Rimmer. And very nearly Peter Cormack.
Whitehead into the box. A good little centre, and that's a goal.
But after 4 years in the First Division, sadly, City's era up there ended. It's history now, isn't it, Kevin, that City eventually sold you. In fact, we see the last game you played for Bristol City. It was against Carlisle. It was October 1981. There's one of David Rogers' celebrated goals. He didn't score many, but he enjoyed them all very much, and why not? Overall, though, sad times for the club. City were on the slide, down to the Second Division, then down to the Third, on to the Fourth, and along that trail you left. You leave Ashton Gate Turf for the very last time, Kevin. You're sold to Crystal Palace. But do you think the huge promise of those early days, in fact, was justified in your subsequent career?
No, Roger, not really. I wasn't at all happy with the way it went when I went to Crystal Palace, mainly because the first year went very well. After this, I had a pelvic injury that lasted 8 months. Then I just recovered from that. Then I had the knee injury that really has put me out of the game.
Do lads like you who are dedicated to soccer from such an early age run the risk of damage in later life because you do too much too early in life?
Right, I think everybody knows this, Roger. If you look back over the players that have finished the game, you can see now a lot of them are hobbling around and they have bad joints, ankles and knees especially.
So would you do it the same again?
Of course. Of course. I had some very good years, Roger. I mean, all footballers, they have very good years. And you can't look back and you can't regret, especially when you've had good years. Okay, you can say, I wish I could have done this and I wish I'd have done that. But it doesn't work that way.
What about the injections you've had? I mean, you've had a lot of the needle to try and keep yourself in the game, haven't you?
Right, sure. Really, it was a combination of people's faults, really, especially mine, because I wanted to carry on playing. The doctors told me as early as the first operation that I remember sitting in the hospital and my family around me, and the doctor walked in and he said, what else can you do? Because you may not play again. And that was early as the first operation in 83. And since then, Roger, it's just been a series of operations to keep playing. And 2 years ago, they said, well, if you have another 2 years, you've done well, which I had. Okay, I ended up having four operations in the last 6 or 7 months, but it was worth it. Those extra 2 years were worth it. I wouldn't swap the past for anything.
What are you going to do now?
Relax a little bit. I suppose I had to start earning a living, really.
What are you into?
Investments, really.
Ironically, it was your baby brother Gary, wasn't it, who we saw earlier, as someone who's always been your shadow, who was to get his big chance in Bristol with the Rovers, and then on to Tottenham, and in fact, England.
The height of Butcher, height of the England captain, in Greenish Mark, it's the number 7, Gary Mabbutt, taken by Glenn Hoddle, and at the other end is his Tottenham teammate with a magnificent leap.
You taught him?
I taught him a lot. Maybe not so much on the field, maybe off the field I taught him.
What did you teach him off the field?
Secrets, Roger.
Yeah?
See, I'll tell you later.
Yeah?
But, Gary's his own man now, and he grew up, he listened to my father. He probably learned from a lot of my mistakes, especially on the publicity side. He kept quiet. He did it the right way. He's a very good professional. And it shows in his game now. And he's come through very good. I mean, he's one of the most wanted players in the country at this moment in time. And he's done very well.
Your father was what, the ideal father for lads who want to be sporting success boys? I mean, he really did bring you up great,
sure.
Didn't he? You owe him a big debt, don't you?
Sure. I mean, Gary and myself owe him a big debt. Because at the time, at 14, 13, 14, 15, when all my friends were, I'd do the new girlfriends or working to raise money to go out Friday, Saturday nights or whatever at this age, we were out in the backyard hammering the football around. And I wouldn't have had the years I've had if it hadn't been for the dedication, really, he put into our early career. And you ask Gary this question now about my father, and he can't speak highly of him. Because Gary is where he is today, really, because of the dedication in the early years of my father.
He can't speak highly enough of him. You'd like, though, wouldn't you, and you're not going to have it, Mabbutt brothers playing for England together.
Sure. And we always talked about it, Roger. I mean, you know. I mean,
could have happened, couldn't it? But for the injury?
Could have happened.
But for the injury?
It could have happened, but for the injury. I mean, who knows? I mean, maybe I didn't have the ability to play for England. You can look back and you can say, but the most important thing now is Gary's playing for England. He's very, very successful. I go and watch him an awful lot. It gives me a great deal of pleasure, especially to see the way he handles it, because he's very, very cool in the way he handles it all. It's not a big thing to him.
Perhaps he learnt from the hero mobile that you had that he's not going to have one of those.
Yeah. Maybe he did. Maybe I did come in useful after all. I have to speak to him about that. But there's no regrets.
So that's how we'll leave it then. Kevin Mabbutt, thanks for coming and sharing again with us some of those magic moments you provided for West Country fans all those years ago.
Thank you. Nice to look back, yeah.